Yes, Eric. Yes, Eric, what can I do for you? Eric the Midget.
Will you stop referring to me by that, please?
No.
I was calling because I sent Will a couple of the outlines that I've done for movie scripts.
What happened to your book, Dougie the Puggy?
It's pretty much finished.
Yeah, but have you had any nibbles from publishers?
No.
All right. And you now are writing screenplays.
Yeah, the outlines so far.
Jumping from one success to another.
Yeah. Why not sell Dougie the Puggy and then write the screenplay?
Yeah,
but okay.
I think you ought to concentrate on your first book.
And what is your screenplay about?
Well, the one of them... Oh, hang on. Let me open one.
Oh, Bill Shatner's on the phone. I got to go, Eric.
Sorry, Eric. We have a big star.
I got a big star on the phone.
Well, you have the two... things there in front of you.
Nobody gives a fuck about him. Bye, Eric.
Badass.
See you later. You suck at writing. You suck at writing.
William Shatner, Eric. All right, I got to go. I'll talk to you tomorrow.
Bye, Eric. You suck. Bye.
You're not on air tomorrow.
Oh.
All right, call him anyway, douchebag. Bye.
Eric, I'll read your synopses, or I'll have Will explain it to me, all right, and then we'll get to it on Monday.
One of them reveals something about the girlfriend thing.
They all suck. We'll see you Monday.
It was a joke.
All right. Thank you, Eric.
He was in on it.
You're awful. Bye.
It's a joke on you.
Thanks, Eric.
You're talentless. We'll see you, buddy.
Yeah, whatever, bad actor.
All right. That was a joke? Ha ha.
All right. Bill Shatner, my old friend.
Howard.
You sound exhausted.
Where are you,
Bill? Really exhausted.
That's
I'm
big
not
foot.
Exhausted. It's only four. What is it, four? Well, it's 5 o'clock in the morning.
Either you're exhausted or you're drunk.
I'm full of life and liberty here.
Are you on a speakerphone?
Is this better?
Yeah.
That's
oh,
so
Christ
much better.
Say.
You sounded drunk,
I was
going to
take the easy way out, but no, not for Howard.
A speakerphone. No one could even understand you.
No, well, here now we are. Howard, I haven't spoken to you in years.
Hey, you know, ever since you got on Boston Legal...
No, ever since you've been on Sirius Radio.
No, you know
you
what
You were
happened?
Here once, weren't you?
Yeah, but I'll tell you what it is. Bill Shatner.
He doesn't need us.
Doesn't need us anymore.
No, that's not true.
No.
I need you desperately.
Now that you can't get in Star Trek, you need us.
Robin.
When you signed... Yeah, by the way, what's going on? What do you care if you're in the new Star Trek or not? You're carrying on like a crazy man.
Who? I've just...
You.
Every time somebody says, are you in the new Star Trek? I say, no. Well, how do you feel? Well, I'm disappointed. And they blow it up. Who cares?
You don't care, right?
No, I don't care.
You know what? You did the Star Trek thing, and now you're doing Boston Legal. You don't
That's
need
right.
it.
Let them fall on their face
for?
Without you.
Yeah, let Leonard Nimoy do it.
Well, yeah, and he is doing it.
Are you? But be serious with me. It does upset you a little bit that they asked Nimoy
well,
back.
Of course it does. I mean, it's a stupid business decision as far as I'm concerned.
Did you call J.J. Abrams, the producer and director of the new Star Trek?
Well, actually, he called me a couple of times. He met with me a couple of times.
Right.
You know, he was saying,
he decided...
well, we're going to do it, and we're going to get, and I want to do. And I said, well, it sounds great. What kind of a script? Well, I can't tell you now, but we're going to do, and we're going to go. And I said, well, that's fine. You know, call me. And then he called another time. He came down to the set, actually, to Boston Legal, and sat around, and we talked. I think we had lunch, and we're going to do, and we're going to go, and I'm going to get.
But, Bill, does that make you think that he was thinking of using you, and after meeting you and seeing you at Boston Legal, he didn't want you?
He probably heard that tape of you reaming out that voiceover session where, you know, you yell at the guy for making you do the line
oh,
reading.
Oh, my God. Well, that was, well, anyway, that's another whole story. But I hope not. That would sort of destroy my self-image, wouldn't it? A guy comes up and says, you know, I'd like to use it, but now that I've met you, I'm not going to.
Yeah, I mean, but you know what? It is funny to me. Here you are having a success with Boston Legal. You're more popular than ever. And you would think from a economic standpoint that rather than use Nimoy, who, quite frankly...
doesn't have an outlet.
I mean, nobody really cares about him anymore, let's be honest. I mean, you've got the relevant show. You've got the more high-profile career. From a business standpoint, why not put Shatner in instead of Nimoy?
Well, I agree with that. I've been saying a part of what you said. Leonard is a wonderful guy.
Leonard's irrelevant, correct?
No, he's relevant in life. and he's relevant to the part of Spock, and he's a wonderful actor, and he's my dear friend, and all that.
Yeah, we all know that. But did Nimoy call you and say, you know, Bill, if you're not in this, I'm not in it?
No. I called Nimoy. I said, am I in it? He says, no, you're not.
Did it upset you that George Takei now is having success in Heroes?
I don't even know who George is. What is George?
And even Uhura. I mean,
Uhura's on Heroes, too.
That's wonderful. They should load themselves up with all these wonderful people and talents and have a good time.
You don't care.
I don't even.
I think you're upset that Nimoy took the job and didn't
think of you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's typical
Aren't
Nimoy.
Aren't you two a team?
Yeah, up until a point.
No.
Would you have done the movie without Nimoy?
I have always. I did.
You did one without him.
I did one without him, but I begged him to be in that movie. He didn't want to be in that last movie because the part of Spock wasn't relevant enough, and apparently Spock is really relevant in this movie. But I agree with you in that it's not a wise business decision to not include both characters. I don't understand that.
No, I'm very upset
for
you.
I'm just sort of sad that I'm not in it with everybody. And
how do you feel about them now casting younger actors and going back?
Well, time marches on, Robin, and I'm aware of that.
Well, you're saying William Shatner isn't young?
No, I'm not saying anything.
No, she's saying that because that's the truth. But neither is she, you know what I mean?
All right.
Now, Bill.
Have you still got your long black locks?
Bill, tell me about Boston.
Have you shaved your head?
Tell me something about Boston Legal for a second here.
Yeah.
Because I'm curious.
Yeah.
You signed up to do that show.
Yeah.
I would say, how many years ago now did you sign up to do that?
We're in our fourth season.
All right. And you probably negotiated a contract that you were less than happy with. Am I correct?
Oh, I was delighted. I was delighted.
But they got you at a time where, of course, you know, they got you probably cheaper than what they'd have to pay now. Have you had a renegotiation?
Well, the situation is this. I signed for 4 years. And this is our fourth season.
Go ahead.
So if it goes to a fifth season and they want me, they have to renegotiate the contract. They're aware of that, and so am I.
No, at no time during the four-year contract did you say to them, I know I signed a contract, I'm a man of honor, of course I'll abide by it, but listen, I am probably the reason this show is successful.
No, I haven't said that.
You know you're very hot right now. Have you said to them, I want you to reward me?
I got a contract, I understand that, and I'm abiding by the contract, but should you want me, my contract's up in this fourth year, we'll have to renegotiate, so everybody understands that. So if they decide to renew the show, that's an interesting question, too.
Are you saying it might not be renewed?
Well, every year you're in jeopardy. Every show, every year.
Is the show doing well in the ratings?
Pretty well. We've got a core audience. We're up there sometimes in the 20s.
What do you get, about $100,000 an episode?
I'm embarrassed by discussion of
Don't be embarrassed at all. There's no reason for shame here. You're doing very well.
The reason for shame is I don't want my children to know how much I make.
Oh, you're still hiding from them.
I don't want my wife to know.
You're not kidding.
I mean, I don't mind the audience knowing.
This is a man who has shelled out much alimony. I mean, he doesn't want
anything. He'd like to keep
people
his cards
stick
close
their fingers
to
in my eyes and want more money.
Yeah.
You got a prenup.
See, now that you're making more money on that series, we want more money.
You've got a prenup with this new broad, right?
Yes.
Of course.
You know, any marriage, if you...
Was that uncomfortable for you, having to say to her, look, honey,
it is uncomfortable because somehow it flies in the face of true love, doesn't it?
Sure. How many years does she have to be with you before she gets any money?
Oh, no, she's long ago. I just want to be fair. And
what is fair? What is fair?
A dollar for each year of marriage.
And what is fair, you see?
Right.
For example, did you do anything like that?
Prenup? I would not get married without a prenup. Absolutely.
Well, that's what I mean.
It's very uncomfortable, though.
But
it really
what
is
fair? Well, everybody's glossing over.
Well, fair is fair. Fair is fair,
Robin. Come on with you. That's very good. Fair is fair.
What's your situation?
Yeah, what is going on there? Robin has lost a tremendous amount of weight. She is now full vegan.
Yes, I'm very ill.
No,
Bill,
she has
beating up on me.
Bill, she's lost a ton of weight.
Really?
Her sexuality has awakened.
Oh,
really?
She broke
she's
up
like
with
a
her.
Lusty broad now.
She broke up with her boyfriend. She's dating two men now.
Oh, here we
One
go.
One is a professional comedian, and the other one is a porn star.
He's weaving tails.
No.
So she's got one to make her laugh and one to make her laugh.
Right. Now, let me say this, that I haven't seen you in a while.
No, we had dinner that time. I enjoyed it. And then, like J.J. Abrams, you never had dinner with me again.
Once was enough. I think we all felt that way, didn't we?
So you had the same reaction to me as J.J. Abrams.
No, you're a wonderful man. And but here's the thing, you're promoting a, you're involved
hey,
in
listen,
this.
I got to tell you about this because that's why I've called, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, Bill Shatner, William Shatner, or may I say Bill?
Please.
Yeah.
Howie.
Yeah, Bill Shatner is involved, you know. He always has businesses on the side.
Of course.
But I figured with Boston Legal, all that
he
was
going to... He just do acting.
No, but he always has something going on.
What is he doing now?
Well, you got to hear this because this is one of the great... This is one of the... I don't have to tell you. You're in the business of doing this. That when you do a project, you need to promote it. And that's what we do, and you're so helpful so many times to
promote.
Allow a performer to... Tell your audience, hey, this is going on. If you want to evade yourself, to go see this movie or read this book. So in this case, I've got a book and a record. I've got a book, a record called Exodus. It's the abbreviated version of the biblical chapter of Exodus. I did it with a choral group of 350 people, a 72-piece orchestra, and there's a moment in Exodus when the actor and the audience connect, and you can almost hear it on the DVD. So there's a DVD out there called Exodus. It's a beautifully rendered thing. It's
Bill, can I say something?
Wait, a choral group?
Yeah, are you reading the Bible to a choral group?
Yes.
I like this plug, but this time, do the plug again, but do it with more enthusiasm, if you could.
No, that's it's really good, and you must hear it. That's the record,
all
Exodus.
Right.
It's coming into the record stores, wherever records are sold, right now. But the one I want to tell you about is the book Academy. Now, and you're going to enjoy the story because they wouldn't let me write the book. Academy is my unique artistic vision of how Star Trek began, how young Jim Kirk and young Spock met, the soldiers of Darfur 300 years from now are the scourge, and the fight, that's the struggle that begins with...
You're still writing Star Trek books?
Yeah, you should be writing Boston Legal books now.
Why don't you write a Boston Legal series?
In due time. But the Academy Collision Course is in bookstores right now. Now, here comes the great part. Tahiti Village, which you just played an ad on, said to me, you do a book signing at Tahiti Village, and we will put up anybody who comes to Las Vegas, they've got to get to Las Vegas on their own, we'll put them up at a hotel, at a great hotel, for 2 nights and 3 days, and give them a book, and you'll sign it all for free.
What is the catch?
The catch is... There's no catch.
Wait. I've heard this ad before. I didn't even know you were involved with this.
Listen to this great promotion.
Tahiti Village is what?
Tahiti
what is it?
Village. I'm going to sign books on Monday, the 19th.
And if I want to be there, I could say to Tahiti Village, fly me down for free.
No, they don't fly
you. No, you got to get there for free. You
got to
get there on your own.
Okay.
You can stay there 2 nights. And 3 days for free.
In Tahiti Village.
It's a book for free, and you get all the information.
And I can meet with you.
And you meet with me at this book signing. 888-30-GO-NOW.
That sounds like a good deal.
Go now.
And what are they going to do? What are they going to do with me when I get down there? Do I got to watch a movie?
Nothing. No. You're going to see Tahiti Village. You heard the ad.
Is this in Scientology or anything?
No. I'm telling you, Howard, if you come down... First of all, you and I will have lunch.
Will they get me laid?
Now, you got to have lunch with Bill.
If I have to have lunch with you, then I'm not going.
After lunch, you're on your own.
You almost had me. I didn't know I had lunch with you. I was almost going to fly in.
All right. To get you down there, you don't have to have lunch.
All right, you're saying any human being on this planet who wants to meet William Shatner, go to Vegas. If I fly myself down there, you'll let me stay at Tahiti Village for two days.
You're not staying at Tahiti. You're staying at a great hotel.
Any hotel.
Not even Tahiti Village.
What hotel am I staying at?
Two nights free. 3 days free, and a book, and I'll sign it all for nothing, and you dial 888-30, go now. It's one of the great promotions. I've never heard of anything like this.
And why is Tahiti Village being so kind to me? What do they
because
want me to do?
They want you to know. They want you to know about Tahiti Village.
So they're going to give me a little.
I want you to buy a book.
So they're going to give me a little indoctrination into Tahiti Village.
Maybe, maybe not. You go, you don't go. I'm not sure about that.
All right.
But you don't have any obligations. You, the person going down there, have no other no obligation. You don't even have to come to the book signing.
I wonder what they're paying you to do this.
They're not paying me anything.
This Tahiti Village has got a lot of money.
Oh, yeah. They are always spreading
it around. They are buying
they're good,
books.
They're good dudes. I'll do that. They're I'd go meet Bill books. Shatner and be in Vegas.
Absolutely. Why not?
And they're buying. How many books are they buying?
Who knows? How many people are coming down?
Right.
So the experiment is this. On Howard Stern Show, this unique offer of 888-30-GO-NOW, and go call that number and find out more about it.
You're never going to retire, are you?
I'm never going to retire, Howard.
Look at you.
I'm hanging onto your hair tail.
You're unbelievable.
I actually think Bill is happier now and more satisfied with his career and his personal life than ever in his life.
You getting laid still?
Well, I'm married.
Yeah, but.
So I'm.
Viagra or no Viagra?
There's a joke there, but I can't.
Are you Viagra-ing or not?
No, what are you talking about?
I think he's Viagra-ing.
Really?
Yes. I say,
are you rubbing any testosterone?
No. I'm saying you're taking Viagra.
No.
I know you.
No.
You want it hard and firm.
He wants the stiffy of a 25-year-old.
You want the stiffy of a 25-year-old.
The only firm I'm connected to is Crane, Pool, and Schmidt, the law firm.
I don't know about you. You're not coming clean with me. You need to get in here.
I know. As soon as I'm in New York, I'll call you.
He's never coming to New York.
I got to go fly to Vegas to see him. All right. So William Shatner announcing that Tahiti Village is willing to put you up in a hotel for two nights.
Exactly.
And 3 days. And you can go down and you get a free book from Bill Shatner. You get to meet him and, you know, sign stuff. And you know,
you'll have a signed copy of his book.
And if William Shatner's in a good mood, he might actually even look you in the eye.
That's exactly right.
And what is the phone number?
People, I'm gonna be very quick. And if there's not a lot of people, I'll kill myself.
Let me have the phone number, please.
What?
Let me have the phone number one more time.
Gee, I don't know. Should I give it to you?
Yeah.
Give it to us again.
888-30. Go now. It is the most remarkable book promotion I have ever heard of.
All right, listen, you're a good friend of the show, and I hope
you
to see you soon. We love you.
Well, I love you guys. And I really can't wait to see you, and as soon as I'm in New York, I'll give you
a go back to sleep.
Oh, yeah, sure.
And kiss that lovely woman for me.
I will, my lovely wife, Elizabeth.
Yes.
Howard, it's good to... Are you well?
Am I well?
Yes.
Well, when have I ever been well?
I mean,
survive.
Guy, you can get dreadful things.
No, I'm fine.
Are you happy?
I'm happy. Everything's good.
Great.
All right. Later. Go back to sleep.
And Robin?
Yes?
It sounds great.
All right.
All right, you'll see.
You're laughing all the way to the sperm bank.
The boobs are still big, but the body is slimmer. You'll like what you see, I guarantee it.
I might even avail myself.
She was even wearing a red thong the other day.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Fantastic. It's a pleasure to talk to you. Take care of yourselves.
You're not cheating on your wife?
Never.
Look at you. Look at you playing it straight.
Mr. Faithful.
Mr. Faithful.
You're the first one to find out, too, I know.
Look at you, you know? You've mellowed.
I have.
All right, thank you.
Take care.
William Shatner, everybody.
Bye-bye.
The guy loves to work.
Oh, my goodness. Still writing books.
Writing books. Tahiti Village.
I mean, with that Captain Kirk, he's still thinking of Kirk and Spock, how they met.
Someone told me Bill Shatner's like 76 years old. Like, why would you care anymore?
Yeah, he's up there.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, those Twilight Zones, that's a mid-50s.
Yeah. Yeah, he's been around.
Amazing.
I just saw that one the other day where he's on a plane and he sees that weird creature.
Love that one,
Dominic, you're on the air.
I wanted to ask him, actually, that did he realize that Mickey Rooney is doing the same promotion 2 weeks from now?
You know who else is doing it, too? Who does it? Remember the chick who...
Tanya Roberts.
Tanya Roberts. Who was she in the movies?
She was Sheena.
Sheena, Queen of the Jungle.
Why would he... I mean, I don't even...
Alan Thicke, too.
Oh, Alan Thicke?
I think he does it, too. He does Tahiti Village.
But he's like the hottest guy on TV now, that show.
William Shatner.
The guy from Love Boat, the doctor, he was doing it.
Yeah, Bernie Coppell.
Yeah.
You could go down and see him at Tahiti Village. You know what, though? I tell you why. I think that, like, a lot of these guys, like William Shatner... struggled for a long time.
And he's won and lost a million fortunes.
Yeah.
He said that.
His, one of the wives, I think the second wife, really cleaned him out. He didn't have a prenup.
Remember, he was living in a trailer, and he was the star of a TV show?
I remember he was doing the butter commercials. Like, all that butter money, I think, went right out the window. So,
but he's not a gambler, right?
No. That's
but
not
he did have horses, which is...
Yeah, but he raised horses as a
not
business.
Not a great business to be in, either.
Butch Patrick, Eddie Munster, does
Tahiti
Village.
That's right, yeah.
And Buzz Aldrin. Buzz Aldrin called in about Tahiti
Village. That's right, yeah. They're getting everybody.
Yeah, I saw Buzz Aldrin at an airport not too long ago.
I think Bill Shatner's kind of like, you know what? I'm going to take money wherever I, you know...
If they're offering money, he's taking it.
You know what they might also do? They might give you stock in the company or something.
Yeah, oh yeah.
So that you get on a capital gain basis.
Right.
That's the only possibility. Because really,
I mean, but it's good for the public. Why not? I mean, you want to go down to Vegas? You get a free, hotel. And
it's great for the public. I'm just wondering why someone like him would do it. I mean, he's got to be very, very wealthy.
I thought so. All right, Dominic. Thanks. Perfect. But Bill Shatner doesn't turn down anything. He loves it.
Oh, do you remember he used to promote some sort of paintball game?
Yeah.
And then he had phone cards where everyone could get together at one point and talk to Mr. Spock?
No, it was phone cards. It was him and Jean-Luc Picard, the other captain of Star Trek, were going to have a big phone conference. You had to buy a special phone card for it. That was before Boston Legal. I felt bad. He was promoting paintball and special phone cards all in the same week.
We remember those days.
All right. And wasn't he judging the cooking contest?
He was with Iron Chef for a while.
Yeah. I love him. Then he had a music album. Speaking of music albums, let me give you the top five.
Well, what is that with reading Exodus with a choral group behind him? I don't know what he's doing.
Who's buying that? You mean he's going to read Exodus?
Yeah. We got to get that.
That's insane.
You could tell what a pro he is, too. Like that roast I did for him, man. They trotted him out. He sat there, took whatever he had to take, got up there and rattled off jokes off those cue cards, off that prompter, like a pro you've never seen.
Oh, yeah.
And killed and just like, fuck it, where's my check?
Mm-hmm.
The guy's a good actor.
Well, you know, the other thing we didn't get into, you know, because I remember George talking about the last big Star Trek, some anniversary of Star Trek, and of course Leonard and William Shatner were going to be there, and they're treated differently than everybody else in the crew.
Well, of course.
You know, they're ushered in, almost carried in. They don't have to walk. They don't touch the ground. They get a ton of money, and they don't have to be there very long.
Here's your top five songs in the country. This is called Bubbly by Colby Calais.
Who?
Yeah, this is the number five song in the country right now.
Starts in my toes and I crinkle my nose wherever
I've
it
heard
goes.
This.
I actually
always
like this song.
Know that you make me smile, please stay for
I know that song. I've heard
I
it.
I know that and I like it. I
Soldier
don't know
Boys,
her name.
Soldier Boys crank that as number four.
Soldier Boy, I'm in it. Why me crank it? Why me roll? Why me crank
it? Alicia Keys has a number three song in the country. It's called No One. Timberland has the number two song, Apologize. And number one is Kiss Kiss. I don't even know that song.
I haven't heard that one.
I don't know. I'm officially old. I don't know any of those songs, except for the bubbly one.
But all you have to do is turn on Hits.
Hits 1. I know. I haven't been listening to Hits 1.
My friend.
I've been listening to Coffee House. And that's... In Channel 9, the hits of the 90s.
The Pulse.
I like that one. And I like the announcers. They come on, they give you a little bit of patter, but not too much, and they get right back to the music. Especially like when I'm having a party, I have it on. It's very cool.
Well, I'll listen to the countdown on the weekends when I have a chance on Hits 1. That's always good to do.
Yeah. It's getting cold again now.
Some dude named Spider, I think.
It's getting cold out now. You know,
it's awful. Yesterday was awful.
I love the cold.
I'm starting to really bum out. I hate the cold.
I do, too. It's awful.
You always say that even in retirement, you wouldn't leave Manhattan. Like, if you
No.
Yeah, but there's a summertime and a spring.
No, I'm definitely moving down to Florida. When I get out of this whole thing, I'll still live in New York, but as soon as it gets cold, I'm going to be like one of those Jews that, you know, the Jews.
What do they call those?
You disappear.
They're called the snowbirds.
Yeah,
you're
no.
gonna be a snowbird.
I thought they were called Jews.
Snow Jews. Yeah. I love that Florida scene, man. I do. There's a particular part of Florida I like.
You know exactly where you're gonna go.
Yeah, I've been looking around for a house. I'm definitely.
You're looking for a house already?
Oh yeah.
You know what it is?
I want to get out.
You know what it is with
me? I hate it.
I'm so out of shape and sluggish that I need this cold air to feel alive on some level.
Yeah, you're like my bulldog. My bulldog likes this kind of weather.
I love it. It like goes. It makes you. It hits you, and you're like, "Wow, I'm awake."
Yeah, no, because you're heavy. If you were thin, you'd be freezing.
When I was thinner, I liked the cold too. I don't know.
Well, look who's back on the phone, Eric the Midget. He's pissed. I hung up on him.
Yeah, he sucks.
Hey, Eric, you were being particularly boring. Honestly, no offense.
Well, I called to talk to you, like I said I was going to call to talk to you about the outline of the script.
Yeah, but we don't care.
Yeah, it was just getting boring. And William Shatner was on the phone.
Wasn't going anywhere.
Well, what? You just
in fact, him promoting Tahiti Village was more interesting than you. And that, you know, that wasn't all that interesting.
He's a sucky-ass old actor on one of the worst...
Bullshit. He's a good actor, man. That's not fair.
Boston Public is one of the worst... Boston Legal is one of the worst TV shows on prime time.
I don't watch Boston Legal, but he was the Captain Kirk. He was on all those...
T.J. Hooker.
I mean, how can you put down that kind of work?
Wait, Eric, on the other line, we have a rock. It's more interesting than you. A
You're
rock
kidding.
Is
an actual rock is calling in?
A rock is calling in.
A stone.
In. Yeah. And it's just a little more interesting than you, Eric.
How's your five chins, Artie?
My what? Oh, my
five
God.
Chins.
You bastard.
I'd shut you up.
My five chins? Are you referring to my my gardeners? They're doing fine.
Hey, Artie, don't stop talking to Eric just because he made fun of your five chins.
So what do you want, Eric?
Do you have the outlines? Because now I'm
not... Hey, Will, what are these outlines? You know what it is? I don't know. For some reason, it's really hard to understand Eric today. His phone connection is particularly bad. Do you know these outlines? Have you read through them, Will?
Well, we tried to get through them, but they're really bad. And it's clear that Johnny Fratto wrote them, too.
Oh.
Oh, is that right?
So that makes enough money.
What the fuck is wrong with you, Will? I wrote those myself.
It just so happens that he lives with a family, with a guy named Johnny, his stepmom, his half-brother Joey, and Johnny Jr.
Oh. No, that's not who I live with. That's... Who Diana lives with it.
Diana DeGarmo's in this one, too?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, because you know what it is. He keeps writing these movies hoping Diana DeGarmo will star in them, and then he can marry her.
She plays a nurse, and he meets her in the hospital.
Read the other one.
What's
I can't
the other
believe...
One?
You know, Eric, what if it came true that somebody put up the financing for you to make a movie, and out of all the starlets in Hollywood, you choose Diana DeGarmo? She's not box office.
He wants to start acting. That's why I just...
How sweet is that? He wrote a screenplay for Diana DeGarmo so that she can start acting.
It's sweet, but I don't think she's going to appreciate it because he has no ability to get a movie made.
Did you write to her or call her mom and explain that now you're writing a movie for Diana DeGarmo?
No, I'm contacting her through the mutual friend, not even... trying to contact her mom.
So you're contacting her through a mutual friend. Who's the mutual friend?
The person that helped me meet Diana at one time.
So you've said to him, I authorize
it's
you.
Her, I think.
You've said to her, I authorize you to contact Diana DeGarmo.
Yeah, whenever she talks to her
Diana's
mom on a regular basis.
So you tell this woman, I'm now writing a screenplay for a Diana?
Can you please get to the other one? Because it reveals something that I started 2 weeks ago.
What is this?
Oh, your fake girlfriend?
Yes.
What does it reveal, Will?
Dude, I'm on like page 4 of 15 here.
This is so boring.
Oh, my God. You can't go through three sentences.
Mind-numbingly boring.
Imagine Eric like writing as opposed to hearing his voice. It's that much more boring.
What was his level of education?
Yeah, what level of education have you had, Eric?
12th. Graduated 12th in my class out of 93 students.
12th grade?
Was it a special school?
Yes.
Was it a special school?
Oh, it wasn't all special ed, you idiot.
Special school for midgets?
No.
Short bus?
All right.
Was everyone an asshole?
Well,
in school?
What are you revealing? We know the girl wasn't your girlfriend.
All right, look. Hey, Eric, I'm happy for you. I hope the screenplay gets made, and I hope Diana DeGarmo marries you. What can I tell you? I really do hope so.
I hope you're arrested.
The second one, the other one, reveals that she's actually not the object of my affection anymore. The girlfriend really is the object of my affection.
All right, what? So you're saying in your new screenplay, you reveal that you're not in love with Diana DeGarmo, but you're in love with this girl that has been you've been talking to on the internet.
Looking at her.
Am I right?
Yes.
Okay.
I don't know. Wow. What's that supposed to mean to us?
What it means, Robin, is while you're all sitting there thinking Eric's in love with Diana DeGarmo, fact is a real romance is developing. And you don't know anything about it.
I'll show Diana.
Oh, my
I'm
goodness.
I'm actually hoping to get to see her on Sunday.
Hoping?
You haven't met the girl you're in love with yet, have you?
Not in person, no, but she is here in California.
So what do you do? Having internet sex or something?
Not even. They're not even doing that. But Eric thinks she's in love. Did she write to you that she's in love with you?
No.
But you've told her you're in love with her?
No, I have not said that yet.
Listen, little John Hinckley.
Eric, I think you're in a relationship where you're in love and the other person isn't.
Well, I'm hoping to change that.
Okay.
Never gonna happen.
Has she said anything to
anybody? Yeah, you're never gonna lose weight, fat ass.
I'm saying I have a better chance of losing weight than you have of ever making a movie with Diane DeGarmo.
Why can't you be happy for Eric Arty? I mean, look what he's done.
Because I don't like this little freak.
He's written a screenplay.
He's a miserable, fat ass loser.
All you say is negative stuff about me, motherfucker.
Yeah, maybe you ought to tell him who you are, Artie, and explain to him that you're a little more important in show business.
There's a hierarchy here, Eric. All right?
And you know,
you're treated
business.
Like shit because you are shit. Oh.
Well, I think
he's
going
to... Yeah, and in the other movie that you guys were first reading about, you're in it, Artie, but I kill you off.
Artie's in the movie, but he's
Artie
dead.
Artie made the movie.
Wait a minute, you put me in the film?
Eric, there's a producer on the phone right now who wants to comment. He's heard about your new script, and perhaps maybe he's interested. This man's name is Jack. He doesn't want his last name on the air. Jack, are you there? Jack, please wake up and comment on Eric's script. All right, Jack fell asleep, unfortunately, Eric, listening to your script, but... Maybe he'll be interested later. All right, Eric, this is exciting. You've written two movie treatments, one starring Diana DeGarmo, and one you admit that Diana DeGarmo really isn't the love of your life.
So you're not in love with Diana anymore. Is that what you're really willing to declare?
Yes.
All right.
All right, good for you. I'm glad you're over.
And she still has no idea who you are.
Thank you, Eric.
Yes, she does.
All right, Eric, good luck with the scripts. Thank you.
There's the entire WWE ECW roster, by the way.
What?
Johnny met the whole company on Monday, and he told me that each and every one of them knows who I am.
Oh, wonderful.
All right.
You're creepy. Bye.
Thanks, Eric.
Bye-bye.
Bye, creepo.
Creepo. <You're creepy.
laughs> Eric the Creep.
I think he may have a new name.
You would not be in Eric's new movie if he asked you to be in it?
I certainly wouldn't audition.
You wouldn't audition?
You wouldn't audition.
If it was just a meeting and then an offer.
You know what would be so ironic? If Eric's script does get picked up, Diana DeGarmo stars in it and then falls in love with him, and Eric doesn't want her because he's in love with someone else.
Yeah, he finally finds new love, and his old love finally realizes she's in love with him.
And then Diana DeGarmo commits suicide because she can't have Eric.
She starts stalking Eric.
That's right.
She's writing scripts for him now.
I hope that doesn't happen.
You see her crying into his PJ pants.
By the way, there's a poll up on howardstern.com. Do you think peace will last between Artie, Sal, and Richard?
Oh.
30% of our audience said yes, 43% said no, and 27% did not care whether Artie, Sal, and Richard...
I admire that 27% greatly.
I do, too.